This is Life Center Around the Table with your host, Paul Martini.
Welcome back to Around the Table podcast. I'm your host, Paul Martini, and we have the amazing Ann Stock, one of the number one podcast viewing guests that we have on is you, Ann. People love you. They love your heart, your stories. I love talking to you. It's always insightful, informative, and you know, inspiring. And so it's great to have you back again. And here on Around the Table, we're going to try to be a bit more topical. We kind of wanted to interview all the pastors and some of our friends and kind of get some background and history on them. So if you ever do come to Life Center and you want to, you're not familiar with everyone, you can go back and really look up their history through this interview. But going forward, we're probably going to be a bit more topical. And today I'm really excited about talking about supernatural encounters and, you know, some of the stories that we've experienced. I'm going to share some of mine. We're going to hear Ann's, and we're really excited about that. So if you're looking for something that's interesting and you want to keep your attention, I think this podcast is going to be one of the best. So, Ann, thanks so much for joining us. It's so good to have you. It's always a pleasure.
It's really fun to do this with you, Paul.
I love the topic of supernatural encounters because, you know, I just have this personal opinion. Of course, it's not, you know, it's based on opinion, but I have this opinion that, you know, you could be the best theologian, you know, you could have the best information, you can have the best arguments, but ultimately, it eventually needs to lead, or you need to have an encounter with who God is. And that it only really happens supernaturally through the Holy Spirit. And many of my friends, whether they're sensationists or not, they often will have a story in their history of how they encounter God. And of course, some of them come through a, you know, a logical premise that, of course, God has to exist because of a philosophical kind of worldview. And then they find that Jesus is so accurately documented in historical records and his resurrection. I mean, you can look this up. But eventually it comes to this encounter where they surrender their life to Jesus. There's a conviction of the Holy Spirit. There's this supernatural happening. And that's maybe, you know, the entry of an encounter with God. But these encounters even continue. And so to ignore the encounters would just do Jesus, do God, do the Spirit of God a disservice. And of course, we're not glorifying just an encounter. We want to glorify Jesus, which they all point to. So I want to say that up front so people don't say, hey, we're going off on some crazy limbs here. The testimony of the encounter really inspires people that they can have an encounter themselves. They are not disqualified to have an encounter. And this is how God moved, even in the New Testament, declaring Jesus' birth. You have the shepherds having encounters. You have Mary having an encounter. You have Joseph having an encounter. You have the wise men having an encounter. I mean, this whole premise of Jesus and the story of Christ coming to the earth is through encounters. That's how people found out. And of course, the angels declared the glory of the Lord and the coming of Jesus Christ. And of course, the prophetic declarations in the Old Testament. So there's all these things happening through encounter. And then you have the early church, right? You know, they have the whole world against them, the whole demonic world against them. They have no resources. I mean, they're not this mega church. They're a poor church. And you have angelic encounters happening. You have people being freed from prisons supernaturally. You have the Spirit of God moving powerfully through the church by the Holy Spirit. So all these things are happening. So I'm just kind of giving some
Paul
little background.
Paul is going to prove that this is okay to talk about.
This is okay. So sorry, Ann, for the long lead-in.
I love that.
I know it's a long lead-in, but I just want us to understand that this is biblical. If you read your Bible and don't see supernatural encounters from the beginning to the end, you're reading it through a lens that chooses not to see it. This is a way that God moves. I do have personal experiences through personal encounters by the Holy Spirit, and some angelic, some demonic, which we can talk about as well. And I think that I hope this inspires you to you know, be aware when God's trying to encounter you, because some of it is awareness.
Yes.
You know, I often think about Joseph. For some reason, there was a point in my life where I just thought that Joseph had this physical encounter with an angel, but it actually was through a dream.
Yes, it was.
And Joseph had the wisdom to recognize that this dream was significant and it was from God. It's very possible that you could get dreams from God and not recognize it and ignore it. But if you have an awareness that God can speak to you in this way, when you have this dream, you're not dismissing it. You're actually going, okay, God, what are you saying? Is this true? Is this directional for my life? Is this a warning dream? Is this a destiny dream? Is this a dream about my own spirituality? What is happening in this dream? What are you saying? And you can pray into that. The Holy Spirit can speak to you. You can ask your pastor about it, maybe, who hopefully they're open to God speaking to you that way. And of course, at Life Center, we are. So, and we have many pastors. You can just call Mike Humphrey or Vinnie Secor. No, I'm just kidding. I just love to send everyone
loaded
to them.
Loaded
on them. But so, Anne, how has supernatural encounters really shaped your life? Has this been something that you feel has been significant for you?
Well, you know, it has. That's otherwise, we probably wouldn't be talking about this.
I know.
But I have like a little lead-in also thought, because I thought, yeah, we are dealing with so much stuff right now. How does a supernatural encounter have anything to do with now? Mm. And Lance Wallnau was recently praying a prayer that said that this is the season where we need supernatural. He's praying into what he calls trophies of grace. It's like Paul conversion experiences for high-level people.
Wow.
And so as you listen to our stories, we can be praying into now trophies of grace that Lance Wallnau asked us to pray about, and those are conversion stories, supernatural conversion stories like Paul of Tarsus.
So good.
And that could help turn this whole system, this whole issue that we're dealing with now.
Yeah, it's so true that the world system that seems to be creating a narrative that is so on attack towards the church, even society. You know, we're worried about society because we love the lost, we love the world, we want to change, and it ultimately it needs to be that the people who are making these decisions and who are part of that system have this God experience. And man, I even forgot about Paul. Of course, he had this amazing conversion where Jesus appears to him. He becomes blind.
Yeah, and then, he was opposed. He was opposed, and it put him completely on the opposite.
Yeah, it's the encounter that changed his mind. And then God has to have an encounter with Ananias
to tell him to pray. To cooperate. Yeah.
So maybe there's a trophies of grace on both sides, where the lost has to have this encounter, you know, these supernatural encounters with Jesus that we pray happen sovereignly. And then the church, leaders of the church say, hey, this person now who you thought was against you is going to be for the Lord.
Yeah, it usually takes two. It took Mary and Joseph to get something to, you know, they had to each have a belief and an encounter. So, yep.
So good.
So one of the encounters that really stands out in my life personally, and I know some people have heard this story, but there's always new people listening.
Sure.
I wonder why people have encounters, and this one I still don't know exactly, but I do know that encounters happen at a season of transition. Mm. And so I'm really expecting a lot of encounters to be transpiring right around now, because this is certainly a season of transition. So look for it and be open to it. But my what I would call a really clear encounter, probably one of the biggest life encounters, was I had an encounter with an angel. It was the afternoon of December 31st, 1999. It was the very last hours of the century. And I was driving home from the church to get ready for Y2K or whatever else right. we were expecting that night.
I remember that.
And I was in a big hurry, and I saw in the Camp Hill Borough, which was very unlikely, a homeless man on the side of the street. And he could not get his package up the curb. He was struggling to get his package. It was
in, like on a cart?
Yes, it was on a cart, and he had like a walking stick. And I thought, why doesn't someone help that man? But I don't usually stop and help men because I was driving alone. Mm-hmm. But I felt I should just drive around the four blocks, and I thought, if he's still there, struggling at the same curb, I'm going to help him. So I went around the four blocks, and when I got to the spot, yes, he was still there. He was in a big coat, a big, like, fur, funky fur coat, and it was when I got close, I realized it was a black woman, and I said, can I help you? And she said, yeah, I'm going to Harrisburg. And I realized, she said, I'm going to get the bus. The bus was six blocks away. And I realized she was never going to make that walk because there are several more curbs between there and the bus stop. So I said, well, why don't I just, I'll take you in my car to the bus stop in Harrisburg. She's trying to take the Camp Hill bus to the Harrisburg bus stop. So I actually had to load her myself into the back seat of the car and her packages because I couldn't get her into the front. I just need to get all the space for her. It was a little difficult, but it's only like a 6-minute drive, so I thought I'll just drive her. And as soon as I shut the door, she began to prophesy over me. And she began to say, you are the Ram of God. You are God's provision. You've always been God's provision. And then she proceeded to talk about what she'd been doing. She said, I'd been in the mall, and I was helping people heal. I was healing people's backs in the mall. And I have an appointment at 1 o'clock, a lunch appointment at 1 o'clock. And I think I've been to your church. I may have been to your church. She said she was 75 years old. She became a Christian when she was 3 years old. Her name was Mary Magdalene.
What?
And she told me all this crazy, crazy stuff. It didn't make any sense. I thought, okay, this lady is a little screwy.
Wow.
But I arrived 6 minutes later, opened the car door, unloaded her out of the car and put her by the curb, but it was downtown Harrisburg and my door was still open. So I just stepped back 3 steps to shut the door so someone didn't take my door off. When I turned back, she was gone. And I knew she couldn't get up a curb. I knew she couldn't move anywhere. And so what does that mean? I didn't know what it meant. I just came home. I wrote down everything she said. And I still don't know exactly what it means, but I know it was a transition point. See, it was the year that we got the 40th Street property. It was the year where we were going into a whole, not a new century, but a whole new 1,000-year set.
Right, and millennia.
Millennium. And we, I had two weddings, two grandchildren. It was all in that 1 year. It was definitely a transition year. I knew she was speaking to the year to the transition point we were in. I wish I had more understanding. I go back and read her words. I do get a little bit of more understanding, but that was a direct contact with an angel. And yet I still don't know exactly. It wasn't there to protect. She wasn't there to protect me. I think it was like an obedience test. Would you be willing to help someone? I don't know. I'm still looking for insights. Maybe someone who's listening to the podcast can come up with like, hey, I think I know what that means.
Yeah, just put it in the comments
yeah.
and we'll read them. I mean, seriously, you know, in the scriptures, it says that oftentimes we'll be entertaining unaware angels. and our hospitality. But man, I felt the Lord when you were sharing that. It's just so significant. What were you experiencing?
Well,
ahead.
I was when I thought back about it, I thought, okay, I do believe we're at a transition point. When you look in hindsight, like you said, angels showed up for Jesus's appearing. An angel showed up when Joshua was supposed to go in and take the land. An angel showed up for Moses when he had to cross the Red Sea at different points. So I did feel that, okay, we are at a crossover point.
Wow.
And that's why I think people are going to be seeing angels during this season.
Wow.
Because it is a crossover point for so many.
Yeah, it's just so significant. I'm still stunned by this story because
it
just disappointed. What did you feel when you when you just look back and she's gone?
I was scared. Okay. Yeah, I always get a little scared, but it made me immediately go back to the phrase, "I think I'll be coming to your church sometime."
Yeah,
I may have been there before.
Yeah.
So I thought, okay, come to our church.
Yeah.
You know, angels.
And the thing about healing backs.
Oh, what was that?
Well, maybe there's an anointing for healing backs at our church.
I mean, had a terrible back issue at that time, and about 3 years later, I was supernaturally healed.
Wow.
So things did tie in. There was another really supernatural encounter that happened just a couple of months around that time. My daughter was in a crisis of faith, and she lived in Denver, and she had been married, and she just disappeared. And we had no awareness of where she was. And that's horrifying for a parent to have no contact. And it had been a period of months that she was missing. Okay. And, especially a daughter, you're so worried about, so we were very, very worried. And I had taken a prayer class. There was a prayer class that was being led by one of the people of the church. He doesn't attend anymore, but he was training. And he had recommended that night that people bring items, either pictures or items of Connect, and that we were going to pray for these Connect items. So I brought my grown daughter's bear from when she was a little girl. And I put it on the table. And so at the end of the teaching, he invited people to go pray for a contact point to these people. There was no names by mm-hmm. them or anything, just items. This one lady that I'd never seen before, hey, maybe she was an angel too. She picked up the bear and she put it against her chest and started sobbing uncontrollably. And I was so blessed. I said, okay, God, you're going to hear those prayers. She didn't know
whose was what
item belonged to who. And so when I got home that night, my daughter called me. And she said, Mom, you called? I said, no. She said, you left a voicemail and I'm calling to see what you wanted. And I said, but I didn't call. And she said, Mom, I know your voice. Stop that. And I said, well, what time was it? And it was the exact time that this lady was holding the bear crying.
Wow.
And I said, oh, okay, well, what did I say? And she said, I said, could you play it for me? And she said, I already erased it. You know, it just comes up and it goes. And, but from that point on, I had her contact number. I knew she was okay. And it was a real forward step for our healing. But somebody else with my voice, some angel called her.
Wow.
And left a message on her phone that said that indicated that she should call me.
Yeah.
And it was during the time the lady was holding the bear praying
for the
lost daughter.
Wow. That's incredible. That reminds me of when Peter gets freed from the prison. First of all, this angel comes, frees him, guides him through, and it was so probably surreal to Peter. it's even written that he thought it was a dream. Until he gets out into the street and kind of comes to his senses and realizes that this is real. And then the angel disappears. And then when Peter tries to go to the house where, you know, the small group is, or who, you know, his the other disciples, the girl who greets him at the door, between, you know, through the door, she's so excited that Peter's there, she goes to tell leaves him out there. And they say, this is the craziest response. No, that's probably...
it's just his angel.
His angel. Which means that maybe during the beginning of the early church, during this transition time, there were so many angelic encounters.
I believe so.
That
I
this was a norm for them.
So.
This was a norm that they would say, they would be, well, I was just talking to Peter. Yeah. No, you were talking to his angel. Peter's been in jail. Oh, yeah, you're probably right. You know, like, I don't know. I mean, obviously, I'm just reading into this. I'm trying to read between the lines. But that's how we would react.
Yes.
And so, you know, I believe that all of us do have guardian angels, and that some people believe that they actually resemble us or have the ability to manifest in a resemblance of us.
So my angel might have called her or something like that. Who knows what it was?
But glory to God.
And there's so many times, I mean, there was a meaningful fruit on that, but sometimes... it's just because he loves us that he wants to cause us to have an encounter. It's like just to show us that he loves us, just favor. I remember there was a time we were on a special vacation with Georgian and Winnie Banoff and Heidi and Roland Baker. And we were in Turkey and we were in the Black Sea. None of us had ever been there before. And we were in a boat on the Black Sea and we'd taken a ride. Roland Baker, from Heidi Baker, Roland and Heidi Baker, Iris Ministry, said, "Oh, man, I'd love to have an ice cream. You know, I just wish I had some ice cream." And about 5 minutes later, a speedboat, there's no other boats around. We're just in the middle of the Black Sea. A speedboat zips up to us. And says, "Yeah, we're selling ice cream." And they had a little cooler, and we got 6 ice creams. And then I asked the boatman. I said, "Oh, do they just patrol like an ice cream truck?" He said, "No, I've never seen an ice cream boat before." Because Roland Baker wanted an ice cream cone.
That's funny. Wow.
God sent an ice cream cone. Wow. Now, what was that? It was just to say, "I love you."
It's like a smile from heaven.
It's a smile from heaven. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I love that. Yeah. Yeah. And, you know, and that just brings you more love for Christ, you know, just like, God, how is it that you think of me in this way, that you respond in this way? It's so amazing. And, you know, I even think that, you know, when people, you know, Jesus is a great evangelist. I believe that because it's, you know, when you're out in the streets and you're, you know, praying for people or ministering to them, it's almost like he shows up more, you know, and in a sense, the Holy Spirit, well, you know, they get healed in their body. They have a prophetic, you know, word over their life that's accurate, that, you know, only Jesus would know. And they have this encounter with God. If you went up to them and tried to preach to them about the gospel, you know, that sometimes the Holy Spirit will convict, and that's a supernatural thing. But most of the time, they don't want to hear it, especially in a postmodern Christian world. They do not want to hear it. They've heard that story. But when you pray for them and they encounter the living God that's inside of us, who's with us, who wants to touch your life, it's like, wait.
He loves me.
Exactly. What do you say? Tell me more about this Jesus. Tell me more about God. Yeah. Tell me more, because I've just experienced what you were trying to tell me about. And so I think it's not either or, it's both and. You know, talk about the gospel, talk about the kingdom of God, and, you know, live the kingdom of God. Pray, you know, bring this encounter, whether it's through an angel, which is amazing, or through a vision. You know, and what I love about you, and I don't know if you know, I'm letting the cat out of the bag or what, but you seem to always have a now, you know, like a feeler. You know seemingly what God's doing in the moment. That's been my experience personally. And you know, like during our prayer time, you don't have to share what you shared during our prayer time as a church, as a staff on Tuesday. But God gives you these visions too. It's not just a angelic encounter. How do these visions come to you? Is this okay to talk about? your eyes are open and you see a picture? Because I have friends who see that. Mm-hmm. They'll see almost like a movie happening before their eyes. It's superimposed. It's just like a picture. And then some of them, it's in their, you know, it's like the canvas of their mind. You know, they're praying, their eyes are closed, and they're not dreaming.
Right.
They're in a prayer moment, and the Holy Spirit starts showing them something, and they realize it's the Lord. How does the Lord speak to you? Is it a bit of everything?
Both ways. If it's what people call an open vision, that means your eyes are open and you still see it like a movie in front of you. I consider that very significant. Mm. And I say I really need to pay attention to that. Mm-hmm. More of them are impressions.
Mm-hmm.
Like with my eyes closed or my eyes opened, I still feel it and see it. I think I see it. I think I feel it. Mm-hmm. I think it's a blend of seeing and feeling. Mm-hmm. Feeling the feeling behind the image that I see. I don't just
That's really
see the
good.
Image. It's I feel the pain, the need, the greatness, whatever it is, you know, the glory of it. So because I get mostly the feeling. I've had some things where I've experienced the sound a physiological, I don't know if that's a type of vision. I think maybe it's all types of vision, or maybe that's an audio. I don't know what you call a vision and an audio, but that's the best I can describe it. I know that's not very definitive.
No, that's great. I think it's helpful for people because sometimes they're experiencing these things and they don't realize it actually could be the Lord.
Yes.
It's not that they're daydreaming and it's not that they're... just having these randomized thoughts. Sometimes it is, but not all the time. And of course, you have a history with
and
God.
You have to look for the batting average. So I didn't speak up much in the beginning, mm-hmm. but as the time went by, and I saw, oh, that really did play out.
Mm-hmm.
Excuse me.
Do you want like a throat?
No. I'll
thing? I know it's hard.
Sip some water.
Okay.
So sometimes if it keeps coming back, mm-hmm. then I say, okay, this is persistent.
Yeah.
Then it wasn't a thought. It just keeps coming back and coming back and coming back. Or you can rate it by maybe your heart rate. Mm-hmm. Your heart rate goes up. All of your senses become hyperactive. Mm. Like you've become suddenly energized.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it does something to you because it's you're connecting with the supernatural.
So cool.
I don't know.
I had one of my first, when I went to Africa and I just started, I gave my life back to the Lord. I went to Africa to kind of get away. I went on a missions trip to get away to kind of seek the Lord. And so it wasn't because, it was a friend of mine was taking this team over. And so I went. And I said, look, I don't want to do any ministry. I don't think I'm even qualified to do any ministry. I just want to get out of America and, you know, talk to God and I'll come along. And, you know, there was a lot of college age kids. I was, you know, mid-20s, I think early 20s. And kids still, you know, 18, 19 years old that were with us. And so I just was like, let me, I'll help in being a chaperone, making sure everyone's behaving, and but I just won't be able to minister. And so one of the first times it ended up where the leader ended up having to go to another village, the college age kids had no chance of speaking, and this person used to teach me when I was really young. I was young. I was in my early teens. Actually, helped mentor me a little bit in teaching, and so that's a different part of my life. But he said, "Look, Paul, I don't have anyone who could share at this church, and this missionary wants you to share." And da, da, da. And so I said, "Okay." So I did that. I said, "Look, don't just tell the missionary. Don't expect anything really great. If nothing happens, if this is a bad meeting, it's not my fault. It's your fault because you've put me." I tell her that. So no expectation. They said, "Okay." And then the missionary told me, "Listen, I've been going to this village for years. We've been doing a lot of medical missions. They were nurses, but also trying to evangelize." And they said that the people there were not truly converted. They have no expectation of meeting God. They Saturday night they're, you know, worship, doing ancestral worship, and then Sunday morning coming to church for the resources that they provide. But they're really not true conversions, and they're very hard. Where we were, it was a very cold place. It was in the mountains of Lesotho, and so the people she had experienced were just a little hard-hearted. So I'm like, "Oh, great," you know. So I get this little sermonette about, you know, Moses and God leading people out, and I just remember as soon as I started, people, I was saying words, and it was like there was no filter. It wasn't me processing. And in a second, I realized I'm not actually preaching. And I have this out-of-body experience, which I've never had before since. And I see myself preaching to the crowd. And I then come back in my body, and people are weeping, and they're falling out of their chairs. Wow. The missionary's on her face crying.
Wow.
And I just said, "If you want Jesus, come to the front." And the pastor is like, he's my translator, and it's just like, wow, wow. You know, just, and people are crying and weeping, and, you know, and the team, I'm like, "All right, team, let's pray." I don't know what I'm doing. I was like, "God, I was on a hiatus away from the Lord for a few years, and there were things that I've done in that hiatus I won't even mention because it gives Satan too much credit," yeah, you know, kind of thing. And I said, "God, you know what I've done, you know." And of course, I've asked for repentance, but I just felt so disqualified. And I had gone through a divorce. And so I didn't think God would ever use me. And so here I have this encounter with the Lord. People are thinking, "I'm the man of God." I'm not the man of God. I'm the guy who just,
exactly,
God was, I was having the encounter. You know, they don't even know that I was having an encounter. And so it was like one of my first encounters. And then I came back a year later.
And how old were you then?
I can't even remember, but
20s.
Before, probably like 24, wow, something like that, 23. Wow. And then I come back, and now I'm just doing missions, short-term mission trips with the same group, different people, but the same leader. And I in the village praying, and I have this vision where I'm reading a scripture that I didn't have memorized or known, over a pastor who's on his knees in his house, which I had never been to. And it was the weirdest thing. And it was like during the rest time. So I was just kind of praying to the Lord. I see this vision, and I see where people are sitting, the whole thing.
Yeah.
And I come, you know, the rest time's over. I didn't fall asleep. And the person says, "Hey, we're going to the pastor's house for dinner." I said, "Oh, okay." So I do a quick looking for this scripture. I had an index in my Bible, and I looked for the word. You know,
yes,
I don't know if you've ever,
right,
done that,
yes,
before Google existed. I'm in the villages of South Africa. My data on my phone back then, there was even less cellular service.
You used the back of the Bible concordance. Yeah,
yeah. So I'm looking in the back, and I find the verse, and I thought, okay. I said, "Well, if this house looks like the house,
then you'll know.
I'll know that this vision was real." And sure enough, we get there, we have dinner, we go into the other room, there's the setting. People are sitting where I saw them sitting. Now, here's the thing. I had, by that point, I have so much faith. I said, I was praying earlier today, and I had a vision that we were all sitting here and that I read the scripture over this pastor and they translate it. I said, I think I'm supposed to do this. I don't know what it means. So can I read this over you? The pastor comes in front of me and kneels where he was going, you know, where the vision
just
was.
Like the vision.
And I read the scripture verse. I prayed over him. And there was this, and then we came back the next year and his church exploded and they built a school there and they got funding. And not saying that I did that, but I had some small piece
of
what
piece
God
of
wanted
obedience.
To do yeah. over this uh-huh. pastor.
A little piece of obedience.
And that was my experience, like some of my first experience with visions and God showing me glimpses of, you know, so these are some crazy encounters.
Little tiny things. I was thinking of a time, just those small obediences set up for others. You talked about it last time. You said sometimes there's prophetic actions are activations. Mm. They activate other things. And I think sometimes our obedience activates other things. You were obedient and so it happened. One of the strange things that happened, I don't know if it's similar, but along the same lines. I was at a meeting where I was doing, I was alone doing a women's conference. And when we arrived at the place, the first thing they talked about were these super amazing eclairs that were going to be served on Saturday night as a final, you know, this is the final thing, dessert. And everyone talked about these eclairs. And I'd done all the meetings. It was Saturday dinner. And I got to the eclair in the line. Mm-hmm. And the Lord said, if you don't eat that eclair, I'll do something special. I said, they're going to notice I'm not eating their special thing that they've been talking about, and they're going to think I'm so rude. You know, here I'm the guest, and they tried to make it real special for me, and this is what they've been talking about. And so it was a real battle. I did not eat the eclair, and nobody commented. I don't think anyone even noticed that I didn't get to eat the eclair.
And I think this is important part of the story because knowing you more, and you know, those details, you're very aware of people's sensitivities.
I didn't want to hurt anybody's feelings.
You have that situational awareness is what I like to call it.
Yeah, I was worried about that. And that nobody seemed to notice. They didn't. But I was obedient to that really weird directive, don't eat the eclair.
Wow.
And so I went right downstairs and started my message. My message was on the fire of God. And immediately after that, we went to pray, do the pre-service mm-hmm. prayer. And during the pre-service prayer, I got stuck on the floor. Now, I mean seriously stuck. I was panicking. I thought, I can't give my message. I can't get up. I don't know what I'm going to do. And there was two women hosting the conference, and I grabbed one of the ladies by the arm, and she immediately hit the floor, and she couldn't get up, and I could.
Wow.
So this lady's now stuck on the floor. We end our prayer meeting. We walk out. It's just a hotel room. She's stuck on the floor. We just leave her because there's no way she's getting up. I know there's no way she's getting up. I know how stuck she is. So I go downstairs immediately and begin my message. My message was on the fire of God. And so I'm starting my message on the fire of God, and the building starts burning down. Seriously, real, the building burns down. We all have to be evacuated, and all the firemen are there. But the fire, I go to the firemen, and I said, could I tell you there's a woman in this room number, and she is stuck in that room, and you have to go get her because she cannot evacuate. And the firemen went in to get her. Yes, she was still stuck on the floor.
She was.
And the fire was the room directly underneath her.
Huh.
And so she was directly over where the fire was.
She should have cooked.
She should have cooked. Anyway, I gave my message, and then that night at 1:30 I get a knock on my hotel room door. Now, that is not something you usually respond to, but I look through the peek hole, and there it's that woman. So I open the door, and she said, "I feel like I need to tell you about something." And she was having an emotional affair with the pastor of the church. Mm. And before she said that, I actually said to her, "Are you stuck with a fire under you in a burning building?" She said, "Yes, I am stuck with a fire under me in a burning building." And that's what I asked her. Wow. And she said, "Yes, I have. I'm having this emotional affair with the pastor." And we worked it out. It wasn't easy. It took months. She was obedient to come and talk to me. She was obedient to take the steps, but because I was obedient to not eat the thing that I desired, my obedience, I believe it was a kind of activation. It gave her strength. It activated her obedience to not eat the thing that she desired.
Yeah.
And it was a very supernatural God intervention. Both families were saved. The church was saved.
Wow.
And it was based on, don't eat that eclair.
Wow. You know, a lot of you might think, well, that's just so weird. But this is so biblical. I mean, you know, constantly the Lord would have people do things that doesn't make logical sense, that seems insignificant. And it's really just an act of obedience to activate or to, you know, show faith or following him. You have Moses sticking out his stick to part the Red Sea.
What is that?
What's the point?
Why
does he need to stick out his stick? Why can't he wave his hand? Why can't he speak to it? You know, water from a rock, speak to it, hit it. You know, these were miracles, activations that happened through acts of obedience. You know, Jesus, would spit in someone's eye and put mud in there and say, "Go wash." You know, why? Why did they have to do that? You know, there was always some sort of activation that that brought the miracle, the act of obedience. And so I know that might seem like, well, it's just an eclair. Why would that have any supernatural effect?
I still can't figure it out.
But Anne, I think it was, are you going to align yourself with me in this moment?
That's what it was.
I think that's the root of it. You know, and it's like, I need some sort of align. Are you going to align with me in this moment to create an atmosphere for an opening for the angelic or for God to move in a powerful way?
To help someone, yeah.
Yeah, so it's those small, still voices. You know, there's a very famous revivalist in his earlier years, Branham, who, if you read some of his earlier books, now he kind of went off on a direction that we don't agree with towards the end of his life, but the beginning of his life was all the Lord, and he would listen to the still small voice. You know, he would literally have a meeting in 10 minutes, and that's usually when God wants to tell you to do something. Blaine Cook would say, the kingdom of God is inconvenient. It's never the right time. It's never the right moment. You know, it's always and
doesn't look right.
It doesn't look right. And so, you know, this guy, you know, he's got 10 minutes. He needs to be somewhere. He needs to be, you know, a lot of people are depending on him. He's going to dishonor some people.
So I stopped for the angel, even though I was busy.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So this is the, modus operandi that often the Lord will do, you know, and so it's recognizing it. So it's great. It's biblical. It's awesome. I love these stories.
Learning.
Yep.
And it's still not very clear. It's not super. But I thought of another story that has to do with obedience. Not my obedience, but someone else's obedience. And it was actually at one of Randy Clark's meetings in 1995. And it was that season he was doing you know how he gets on topics? Well, his topic for that year was deliverance. Mm. And he was studying it, and he had a lot of power and he was doing deliverance meetings. In his meetings became deliverance wow. meetings, and there was a call for the ministry time, and I was up there. Randy was up on the platform, and I was down right below him. And a man walked up to me, and he said, "I'm having a problem with internet pornography." Mm. He said those words, and I heard this snap in the spirit. It was loud. It was a wow. crack, and it threw me back against the stage. I just thought, what was that? And I came forward, composed myself, and prayed for him. Well, I found out later that the Lord had spoken to him in his seat. If you confess this sin, I'll set you free. And so he went back into the deliverance. This is how we found out the story. Mm-hmm. Back into the prayer room in the back, where people were helping on more specific levels. And he was so horrified when the lineup came. He said, "I have to confess this to that." He said, "I have to confess this to a lady in a blue dress." I mean, he was so hoping it was going to be a man. This was 1995. Yeah. Internet pornography was not. It wasn't something people talked about. Yeah. And wow. 2 months later, a fax, it shows the date time, a fax shows up at our church, and it says, he was from another country. He had traveled countries to get to this meeting. Wow. And he was a missionary and a pastor of a very large church.
Wow.
And he sent a fax, and he said, "To the lady in the blue dress and her husband, could you please come to my country and bring the healing deliverance that, because I'm still set free miraculously."
Wow.
So we did go to his country, and we did go to his church, and he's a thriving pastor to this day. And what did it? It was his obedience. It was not convenient to confess to a woman in a blue dress.
Right.
That was not what he wanted to do. It wasn't. It took all of his strength and all of his obedience. But I believe that little step of obedience, that's what was the snap in the spirit. That's what threw me back. That was so powerful in the spirit. And so he was, tiny speck used me to pray, but that wasn't it. It was his obedience.
Wow, that's powerful. I love that. I have a couple deliverance stories I'd love to share,
maybe
that are just personal. I'll even tell you some of mine. I for some reason, none of my siblings, I'm one of four, I'm the youngest, I have been full of fear. I would be afraid constantly. I didn't want to sleep by myself. I could not sleep in the dark. I could not get a shower I could not get a shower with the door shut. I was too afraid. At 10, 11, 12 years, I was so frightened. Just crazy. I would sleep with the covers over my head. That's how I would sleep. That's how I had to overcome my fear. And I would pray, because my parents were Christians. And I just did not know. Now, logically, there was no reason for me to be afraid. I grew up in a very safe household. My brothers and sisters didn't have the same problem. I go to youth group. I'm just new. I'm young. I'm 13, something like that. I go to youth group. And the youth pastor had this great sermon. I don't remember what it was, but I just remember with my friends, I go up to the front. I don't know what's happening. I don't know the thing. And it's a new Pentecostal church that my parents started going to. And this guy doesn't know anything. And this youth leader wasn't even the youth pastor, it was a youth leader. Puts his hand on me, starts praying for me, and he says, "And I command the spirit of fear to come off of you in Jesus' name." And it was like this understanding. I was like, what? I have a spirit? And then it's just like, aha moment. This was not a logical issue. This was not a young issue, because I'm, you know, 12, 13 years old at this point. How embarrassing, right? It's like, you know, and I'm, you know, it's, you know, I, you know, technically I should kind of be embarrassed. I was afraid till that age, but because it was a spirit that I had given into at some reason, there was a lie, I believe there was, I fed the spirit by submitting to it. And so I get set free radically from the spirit of fear through this prayer. Now, fast forward, I'm in ministry school. I grow up in a very comedic household. I'm the youngest. I try to gain attention through comedy. Growing up, I become really witty. Sarcasm, especially in the area that I lived in, the Philadelphia type of area, is appreciated for some weird reason. And so I have this very sarcastic comedic that I thought was unbelievably great character. Yes,
Charles actually had the same thought. He was the wise guy, and he was so smart, and he had the comebacks. And
oh yeah, and
he was a teenager,
and I was ruthless. I was just, you know, I would say things to people, and I thought that they, even though I'm cutting them up, I thought everyone's laughing, and they're laughing too. And you know, now I realize how
at the expense of others, it wasn't good.
Yeah, yeah. And I found out after this story, I'll tell you, I found out that sarcasm literally means the tearing of the flesh. That's what it means, because it's always at the expense of someone else. And it gets you into this mode of always wanting to see what you can make fun of, you know, instead of really being in the moment and appreciating people and what they have and differences. And so I'm not trying to, because some people do love sarcasm, you know, I'll just say this is what I had to deal with. But I didn't realize it was an issue. And I'm in ministry school, my first year of ministry school, and you'll know this person. I haven't even told her this, but you know this person. It's the craziest thing, and I have a dream. In the dream, I am on a bus, and Jen Yesilonis, do you know who Jen Yesilonis is? She's a first-year student with me in ministry school, and we don't know each other that well. We've only been a few months together in school, and it's not like we hung out with each other, but we had interactions and talks. She's a great, great gal. And in my dream, she sits next to me on the bus, and she says something to me, and I say something really sarcastic that wasn't too mean, but it was just a sarcastic statement. And she looks at me in the dream and says, "I command the spirit to leave you in Jesus' name." And I go, in my dream, I go, what? And in my dream, I black out. And I open my eyes. This is all in the dream. I open my eyes, and I look at Jen, and I say, "What was that?" And she said, "You had a spirit." And I said, and then I wake up. And I realized, and it was just, and it was like something came off me. And I was delivered of it from a spirit of sarcasm that was rooted in meanness. Mm-hmm. You know, it was like this. Now, I'm not saying that that was a spirit of sarcasm, but it was like the spirit was using my wittiness to cut people down. Hurt. That was limiting my growth. Mm-hmm. The Lord didn't want me to have it and was hurting other people. And everyone, you know, I think if people laughed, they kind of laughed uncomfortably, like, ah, ha, ha, ha. You know, I didn't realize it, maybe. And really, I was hurting people. And so anyway, the Lord delivered me from this through somebody in a dream, in my dream, and that person has no idea they did it. You know what I mean? To this day. And I see her, and we've never had that moment where
Or even what she represents, because right. Things are symbolic, so whatever Jen represented to you,
yeah.
You know, simplicity, truth, whatever yeah. she as a her characteristics represented, yeah. that characteristic spoke freedom to you,
and it set me free. I mean, just crazy. I know it's a crazy story.
That is so special.
Yeah, And it was because the Lord wanted me, he loved me so much, he knew that's the way I needed to be set free. And I think this happens, you know, people who are, you know, there's a natural thing that's, you get addicted to things naturally. But yeah, because of the immoral behavior, the character that doesn't reflect Jesus, it totally opens the door, just like manure attracts flies. Mm-hmm. Stinking thinking, stinking talking, stinking behavior attracts demonic spirits. And you might be redeemed and you might ask for forgiveness, but if you continue in habitual, this is my personal opinion and my experience, so it might not reflect every leader in this house, but if you continue in habitual behavior, I believe that creates a stronghold for a demonic attachment. Maybe not full possession, although I've seen confessing Christians be possessed. So however you want to analyze that. But for me, I've seen, and so, yeah, pornography, I've seen people
get free.
Get
in
free.
In a moment.
Just
in
like
a
that.
Moment.
Now, do they have to also resist in the future? For sure, because there's a natural, you know, just like your phone
addiction.
Is addicted.
Yeah.
You know, people are addicted to their phones, including myself sometimes. I've had to cut that off and just say, I need to discipline myself to say no.
Yeah.
Even though my body naturally wants to look at it for no apparent reason. You know, you need to have a stand. And everything we do with the Lord, there's a co-laboring, right?
Right.
Whether it's confessing your sins and accepting Jesus into your heart, you're not just saved walking around doing nothing. There's an action that needs to be taken.
There's a
free will that says, hey, I want to align myself with you, God. You know, every, you know, healing that happens, there's a co-laboring. Except, you know, there are some divine sovereign things. But, you know, usually it's you need to pray for someone. You know, and Jesus uses that as a co-laboring to heal them. Prophetic words, same thing.
As you were speaking about this sarcasm, it just came across my mind. Charles also was sarcastic. He was had a verbal gift. He was quick-witted. He was, and I'm wondering if there are people out there listening who tend towards sarcasm. I think the flip side is an anointing to speak the truth.
Come on.
It's an anointing to bring healing with words. In the same sense that it had the anointing to tear down with words,
sure.
It really is the power
to
bring healing with words. And I know you have that gift and Charles has that gift. So, hey, maybe there's a pattern. If you find yourself as a sarcastic person,
go
for the flip side because you have an anointing, I believe, to bring healing. It's with words.
Yeah.
With words.
Yeah, it's so good.
And to cut to the core of the issue and bring healing to people.
Yeah, it's so good, Anne. Yeah. And I feel the Lord on that. And actually, you know, I had to reject the lie that this is who I am. And I would tell people, hey, this is where I grew, you know, I grew up in the Northeast. This is who I am. It's my culture.
Mm-hmm.
You might be insensitive because you grew up in a soft culture. I grew more, you know, the water in the Northeast is hard water, you know what I mean? And it leaves calcium deposits just the way it is. So I had to reject that lie that this is who I am. It's not who I am. It's what I've allowed, you know, it was a crutch of mine. I was using this as a crutch with the God-given gifts that I was given.
And I think people are getting free right now or listening to this message on realizing that we don't have to be this. We aren't this.
Yeah.
That sentence right there, I think it's setting people free who are listening.
Let me pray for you right now. If you're in the car or if you're listening to this, maybe you're doing something and the Holy Spirit's saying, this is something you struggle with. This is something that's not a part of your life. I don't want it to be a part of your life anymore. Just God, we just speak total freedom, liberty, and deliverance, supernatural deliverance right now, saying we just command that spirit to get off them right now. And we break its assignment. We rip the clothes, you know, in the supernatural, we arrest that spirit in Jesus' name.
Go free.
And
go free.
Tell them to be set free. That's right. In Jesus' name, the person be free. And we bless the redemptive nature of you, Lord, that says that these words will no longer be words of cutting down, but words of building up, words of life, words of healing. God, I pray that this now gift that they have would be used for your glory in every sense of the word. And even if you're a minister and you're hearing this and you've justified your sarcasm, you have your feet in both camps.
Yes.
You build up some days and you cut down some days, or you do both in the same day. I just want to declare real truth of your life, that this isn't really who you are. You are only someone who builds up. The kingdom is always about addition and multiplication. It's not about subtraction and division. And so we just bless the healing nature of your words that are on your life, and we just encourage you to surrender the sarcasm to Jesus right now.
And I'm just getting this word that it is an anointing that you have to cut. So it's an anointing to cut. So what was cutting for damage will be cut for surgery, for beautiful surgery and successful. So it is a cutting anointing. And that the flip side of this, you still get to cut, but you're going to get to cut for good. You're going to get to cut for surgery. You're going to get to cut for healing.
Wow.
You're going to get to cut right in and divide and expose the truth.
Wow, so good. You know, when I was in, I was ministering for a while in Haiti, and I met significant people out there. There's a guy named Mac Barnes who has great ministry out there for a long time. And I don't have a scripture and verse for it, Anne, but I do, you know, believe that the angelic are partnered with what God's doing when it comes to deliverance. And this wonderful deliverance minister, Mac, had chronicled and did the research, but he would see the angelic spiritually arrest the spirit that was on the person. They were using the commandments of God through us as ambassadors, or through the Holy Spirit's direction, and he could see in the spirit, and he would see the demons arrested by the angelic, and then when they were commanded to go, take them to the courts for.
And he knew.
And so I what it really portrays is the power and the authority we have to command these spirits to go through our words. So it's great. So anyway, we kind of went off on a tangent there. It's been an hour already, just
okay,
like that.
Time
but
to
we if you have anything
up.
Else, I think people are probably drawn right now to their so
well,
if there's anything
do,
else you have.
I have one more thought
based
on one encounter that I had. Because the message that it has is so clear, or maybe so unclear. I had always, because Randy Clark's ministry had helped us so much, and the Toronto Renewal, and affected our church in such a beautiful way, I had always hoped that I would have an opportunity to go to the source and attend a Rodney Howard Brown meeting.
Yes.
And every opportunity I had got canceled. And something came up that made it so it was late in the 1990s where I was finally able to attend a Rodney Howard Brown meeting in Washington, D.C. And I went with a group of friends. Charles wasn't there. And I just had waited. I just said, I want to get to the source of this man who impacted Randy. I mean, chain effect. I'm sitting halfway back in the congregation, and in the middle row, like not even on an aisle. And I was so excited to just see, just to observe, just to hear. And Rodney Howard Brown walks out on the stage. And he walks down into the audience, and he points at me. And he says, "You, lady, you." And I look around and said, "Yeah, you in this color blouse, stand up." So I stand up. He said, "Come out in the aisle." No, I am sitting. It's not like I have a sign that says I'm a pastor's wife. There's no name tags. There's nothing.
No special reserve for you.
No special reserve. It's way in the back in the middle of a group of friends. And he gets me out in the aisle, and he said, "Get on either side of her." And he said, got very close to me, and said, where are you from?" And I said, "I," and then I start motioning to my friends, Can't you tell I can't talk? Would you please answer for me? Note they cannot read what I mean with my hand circling like this. And finally, after a painful, maybe 90 seconds.
Oh, man,
awful,
that's a long time.
Awful. Hey, Reese. Oh, no, no. I said Pennsylvania. Each syllable. So painful. I couldn't get out. So awful and so humiliating. And then he doesn't even see that I'm having so much trouble. He says, oh, where in Pennsylvania? Just like that. And now I have to come up with more syllables and say, Harrisburg. Finally, I get it, Harrisburg. And then he does some kind of thing like Phil or something. And my friends let go of me and I fly back and roll under the chairs.
Wow.
And then he prophesied over me. They told me what it was later, friends. But I had another encounter where I was unable to speak. It was in a group situation in Toronto. Randy had called us up. We were supposed to give our testimony. It was finally our chance to say thank you to the revivalist, to the people, John and Carol Arnott. There were 4,000 people there, and Randy had invited us up and said, we could tell our story a little bit and say, thank you so much, so much. All these things have transpired for us, the people we know, and our church. And Charles does a very bad job saying something. I said, what is wrong with you? Why are you not sharing this story? And I grabbed the microphone from him and said, I'm going to tell him. And right then, Randy moves his hand, who had been on the back of Charles, to my back. And all of a sudden, I can't speak either. So that it was, Randy was praying for Charles as he spoke. And he was making no sense. It was just random words that were not even hardly tied together. And I said, I had a boogie board. What? Based in a dream that, oh. My goodness, it was my final chance to say something to John and Carol. Thank you, thank you, thank you. And I had no words. And the Lord, I said, what is that all about? And he just reminded me one more time. It has nothing to do with our ability, our words, and our capacity. He said, I just wanted to show you one more time. It really isn't you. It's the power of God.
Mom.
And it's not your capacities. It's not your skills. It's not your skill set. Mm-hmm. I mean, of course, we're to be obedient and diligent. But like you said earlier, it's not who you are. It's not who you are.
Wow.
It's beyond that. This is so much bigger than us. And so I wanted to conclude with this story of the supernatural always reminds us that it's much bigger than us.
Absolutely. I just think I should share one more story.
Oh, I see.
Sorry.
We just get people going.
And people are going to be, but you know, I think you guys can finish this over 2 days if you want to. But, you know, I just want to share Randy's story that he shared publicly and about a really an amazing encounter he had as a young pastor in the vineyard. He went to a meeting. It was a vineyard meeting. I think it was even pastors there. You know, like there was regional. I know there was regional leaders and local leaders there. And Randy goes up to the altar. He gets prayed for. He goes to the ground and he's feels this power, this fire on his body. He's screamed. He pretzels. When I say pretzeling, if you're just looking at this, it's kind of like his muscles tense up and yeah. It kind of gets contorted. And just honestly, let's call it for what it is. Weird.
Yes,
that is
absolutely
weird. We all think that's weird.
Embarrassing.
It's
awful.
Yeah. No one likes those.
No one
likes to look at it. No one likes it when they're experiencing it. I mean, when you know it's the Lord, you kind of like giggle. And so this is Randy's testimony. And so Randy says he can hear what's going
yes.
on around him.
Yes, you can hear, but that's
and two leaders are watching him, one a local and one a regional or maybe even national leader in the vineyard, which is a significant denomination at the time, still is. And one of them says, do you think it's a demon? And Randy says, in his mind, he goes, "No, no, this is God. Don't call it a demon. It's the Lord." And the other one says,
"Same voice, Randy. Right? Yeah, exactly. Yeah, yeah. You got it."
And the other leader, the regional or national leader, says, "No, I don't think it's a demon. I think it's the Lord. I think he's going to be one of the greatest evangelists in our movement." That's what he says. And Randy, in his mind, goes, "Yes, yes, that one. I like that one," right? Because he can't even think how this could be possible, because he's not known. He has a small church of 50 people, a vineyard plant in St. Louis. Okay, so this is who he is. But Randy's testimony says, he goes, "You know what? They both were right." He says, "I got up from that experience, and I was delivered of a sin that I had struggled with for years, even as a pastor. And I also got this increase in anointing that I've never experienced."
Goodness. That's so true.
And I just want to encourage you, when you have an encounter with
more.
God,
yeah,
He's doing a lot,
and both and more.
You could be set free and get filled in the same moment. You could be anointed for something new and set free from something old in the same moment.
That's absolutely.
There is
right.
destinies that are called out in you, and there is pasts that are erased for you.
That's
there is
right.
so many things that are happening in that moment. But just say, "Lord, I'll be a sail in the wind. Do what you want. If you breathe, I'll move." You know, like, and so, just be open to whatever God wants to do in you, through you, for you, to you, at any moment. And I think encounters is what really, you know, reading the Bible may it make you burn for a greater encounter with God. When you hear a sermon that's anointed, may it make you burn for a greater encounter. And just even in your private time, say, "God, I just, you speak, I want to hear you, I want to see you. However I can encounter you, I want to." Not so that it just benefits me, but it ultimately does bring more glory and worship to him. And he knows that, you know, when you encounter Jesus, there's no going back. There's just no going, you know, there's nothing greater than just experiencing him in such a real, true way. So I hope this podcast blessed you today.
What a beautiful way to conclude. Thanks, yeah. Paul.
I prayed for people. Would you be able to pray for people as well? Because you are anointed and you've had so many experiences, and I think it would just be a great ending to the podcast. So pray for us.
I thank you so much for everyone who's listening. And even as you were listening, I feel like your heart was leaping at different moments. And those are the things that are for you. Those are the things that are being activated and increased in you. Being set free. Mm-hmm. And so even as the Holy Spirit was speaking and speaking to you, and you were having aha moments during the podcast, those are your God encounters. Mm-hmm. And I just thank you that they are real, they are true, and the Holy Spirit is with you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. So good. And once again, thank you for joining us. Can't wait to have you back again. And we'll have to talk about some really other amazing things. So,
more stuff.
So good. It is endless. So, all right. Well, I hope this blessed you today, guys. Thanks for being a part of the podcast, and we will catch you on the flip side. Blessings to you.